Well, I've had an absolutely fantastic day's perch fishing up here at Toft Newton in Market Raisin, Lincolnshire. And today I've had a lot of perch, as you'll probably see in one of the features. A lot of big perch. And they were all coughing out a certain kind of fry. And then it became to a point where I hadn't got the right lure for the situation. I've been using lots of soft plastics like this, but I hadn't really got something to really mimic the fry other than a small fry soft plastic pattern. So I come to see my mate here, the guy who runs the fishery, Andy Hudson, good old pal of mine, and a world-renowned fly tyer, and set him the challenge if he can set me up a fly that looks like, or is even better than one of these soft plastics. What do you reckon, mate?
I reckon we can do it.
Come on then, show us how it's done.
Right, what we've got then is Steve's already given us the type of hook pattern he wants it on, and like a large split shot, which he's going to use as a weighted head on the fly. That's to get the fly down in depth of, depth of up to 20 feet, say. The deepest part of Toft that we've got is 20 feet, and that should be able to get down there should we need it to. We've crimped that shot on there a little bit, and then there's a slight recess left, and what we've been doing is we've just been filling that gap there.
This is witchcraft stuff, this is.
With like a UV type of glue. And I'll just show you what I'm doing there, Steve, is that it's just really to make sure that that weight isn't going to come off. So we keep filling that gap with that.
Because that weight's basically replicating that. It's doing, I don't need a jig head. That's what you're saying.
Exactly. And we're going to borrow Dr. Evil's laser.
No, this is special, this is.
And this laser like just this. Cures that glue instantly. I mean, all these glues, they're a little bit like when you've got a crack in your car windscreen, the sort of things they use to fix that. They all work in a similar kind of way. They're cured by a UV light. Now, if you rub your finger across that, Steve, that glue, is it not completely dry?
That's witchcraft, that is. That's wrong.
And if you layer it, it builds up some strength as well. And what we'll do later on is we'll put some eyes on the side of that to make it actually look like the head of the perch when we've tied it.
Oh, brilliant. I can't wait to see this, mate. This is the magic. This is the magic.
Now, if we're going to compare that to one of your plastic lures, you see there's a lot of inherent movement in them plastic lures.
Yeah.
I'll put that back down. So how do we replicate that with a fly? Well, it can be a bit of a difficult thing, but what we could do is at the back of the hook here, we could actually make this fly articulate. So tying it in two stages is something that'll actually work for us here. Right. So if I take that hook out and just put that to one side, you can actually buy proper, what they call articulated shanks for this. I've not really got any of them to play with, but this is like a snood clip that they use for beach casting. And I've just replaced that in the vise instead of the hook for now. A Dyneema type of thread, so it's very, very strong. So if you see that, I can pull really hard on that to close that gap. I have broke it there, probably too much even.
So what's this doing? You're just closing the gap then,
just closing the gap, but you just don't want it to come away.
So this is going to give all of your fibres like a bit of different movement then?
Yeah, you're basically going to get a wiggle in the tail, which hopefully will be something near towards what you've got with your soft plastic lures. I'm just going to start my thread nearly to the back of there. We'll leave a bit of a gap because it will get covered in a minute.
This is a real art form, this is, mate. You know when you're saying about the movement on the soft plastic and you moved it just like that?
Yeah.
Don't forget there's a jig head on that as well.
It might restrict
the movement, or it might add to the movement, but you've incorporated that into my little fly.
This lure fishing malarkey and what we've been doing with Toft, it's the first real year that we've sort of allowed much of this to go on, and it's been a good experience for me to go out and have a go and study it and watch how the lures move, and stuff that I never knew even existed. Put a bit of super glue on there just to
you keep on, mate, while I'm
to secure
gassing that away as well. So the perch fishing here, it's obviously spectacular. I've been on as the viewers will see in the Angler's Mail coming up soon. Is it a new thing you've tried, or is it a revenue thing, or is it?
It's a bit of a mixture, really. I mean, we've played about with it for years, but we're doing more to actively promote that now.
Because you must see as well, there's a cross. It does look like a crossover, doesn't it? You've got one rod, one artificial lure, as what you've done to a very high level fly fishing.
You tell me if you think I'm wrong, but I mean, how different is it realistically to fly fishing? And I would say the answer's probably not massively.
Not much.
One of the things that I think makes fly fishing great as a sport is the fact that, like you say, you need a net, a bag, you don't need necessarily seat boxes and all the paraphernalia that you get sometimes to go course fishing.
Well, we've both done a lot of course fishing, haven't we? So we both know how much is involved in that match fishing. There is a lot of gear, but there's an art as well to fly fishing, isn't there, with a casting. It's very, very gentlemanly, like, very English sports.
Yeah, but I think you've got to be careful there that what we don't do is we don't want to segregate any discipline of angling. I think you've got to make it accessible to all. And because of the nature of the type of baits we're using, with this both being artificial, I think the perch fishing goes well as an add-on for the fly fishing. Now, this stuff's pretty wicked. We're on to the next bit.
I've got some of that in my pants. This is, I think it's the same stuff.
This is called Blaine Chocolate's Body Wrap. And it's basically a double-edged kind of fibre that when we wind this on these shanks, it's going to splay out.
Is it out of somebody's pants, or is it
made for... No, this is branded as a fly tying product.
Right.
With a lot of fly tying products, they probably come from other industries first, but I've only ever seen this used in fly tying. So what I'm actually going to do with that is I'm going to cut one edge off.
Yeah, going back to the fishing on here, mate, I tell you what has been the biggest bone of contention always in the past is that, if you're using them lures, you'll catch loads of trout. In fact, I've witnessed, and you probably have as well, the opposite.
It's very much, yeah. And
you don't catch as many trout as people would think, you know, as trout waters, or the big Anglian waters and Bristol waters have all experimented and seen that we're not catching a lot of trout.
You're not catching huge numbers of them. I mean, everybody catches an odd one, but is that realistically...
You could say that with all fishing, though. Carp fishing, you catch the odd bream, you know, with fishing, aren't we, at the end of the day?
The other week, I was out trout fishing on here, and I caught a pound and a quarter roach and a size 12 nymph. Well, is that really any different to what we're just describing now?
It's just fishing, isn't it? But I don't think it is detrimental to the trout fishing.
No, not at all.
Because I've caught a lot of big perch today, and I've not had a trout, you know, using those artificial lures.
We'll take a length of that. And what we're going to do, we'll tie an edge in, just like that. Now this is where the whole thing starts to make a bit more sense. We'll just come forward.
It's a ridiculous art form, this is, mate. You make it look really easy.
I've been doing it a long time, Steve.
You haven't, yeah.
We're just going to wind these turns. Now I'm going to put a couple of turns of that body wrap stuff on. The way to get these fibres to separate is with a good old-fashioned toothbrush.
I wondered what that was for.
And I'm just going to comb that just to get that fly, get them fibres stuck out, just to really get them spread well around the shank. Every couple of turns, give it a brush.
How do you discover all this? How do you discover that a toothbrush can be used for fly fishing?
We've used them for ages for this, you know, for brushing out dubbins and things on sort of more imitative trout patterns.
For brushing your teeth?
No, I don't. Oh, separate one for that. That'll be electric, that one. I don't know how well an electric toothbrush would work on this.
No, I can't see that working. So it's just separate, it's just making them all fluffy, isn't it? It's just giving them a bit of a frizz.
Now, the advantage of this type of system of doing it with all these little shanks, as it were, is you can just keep adding them and you can make as many as you like. You can make the fly as big as you like just by adding different sections.
So what section are you doing? This is the articulated piece that you're doing at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, what we'll do is we can either put one or a couple of articulated pieces together. If we do another one after this, it'll just show you.
You'd make a good hairdresser.
Oh, I don't know about that.
It looks lovely, that does.
Just to show you really how it goes together, as it were. Just spread them around with.
So this would be my tail piece then?
This is going to be the tail of the fly.
This is some experimental fry. I've put you on the spot here, haven't I?
Yeah, I mean, I've been tying stuff like this. We obviously, without the jig head, you know, and we use them for fly fishing for pike, which I've done quite a lot of now in my time. I mean, and there are some very, very good pike fly fishers out there. I think with angling in general, I think watercraft something that's very much overlooked. I think that anglers don't bother to learn what we were talking about earlier, which is core skills. I think you get the basic stuff right, or the stuff that's essential, and it stays with you throughout any angling discipline. Right. So what we've done then is...
That always baffles me, that finishing off.
It's like trying to do that phones for you thing with your hand, isn't it? I'll take that off there. And what I'll do is just a little
bit of air product.
Bit of gel.
Bit of gel.
Bit of varnish, just like that. Now, to make the second one, what we're going to do...
Have you already envisaged this finished fly then?
Now, you can see how that, in a minute, that's obviously not ready because it's going to want a bloody trim, but you can see how that just...
Yeah.
The action and the movement of that. And now what I can do, because that's freed up a bit more, it's allowing me to get right the way around that.
Give it a good brush.
Give it a good brush. Obviously... Make sure your eyesight's pretty good and that your dog isn't sat next to you while you're tying flies. Otherwise the dog's going to get bloody well brushed.
So this fly tying business then, how close do you reckon you can mimic what they're feeding straight up? That's the good thing about it. Is I can't go to a shop now and go and buy it. I love using soft plastics. But if I've seen something happening today, like matching the hatch, that's what we're doing, isn't it, really?
I think so.
Except it's not a hatch, it's a fry. Well, it is a hatch, isn't it, really? There's a load of fry. Just come up.
I think it's a... The description of it maybe needs a little bit more defining, if you like, because I think these patterns are... It's not quite an absolutely 100% realistic pattern, but it's got the outline, you know, as a silhouette, obviously. It's very, very suggestive of... what we're trying to achieve, and it's got the right colours and things like eyes that you stick on, and they're all key triggers. I do think it has an effect.
Eyes.
Yeah, I think eyes. We use them on a lot of salmon flies and things like that now, and for me, it's a winner. I think it has a massive effect. So same again. I'm gonna just tie in. If I just take that. Out like that.
So this is the front part of the fly. This is the fish's head, top segment.
Yeah, this is like the main part of the body, because we will put another bit on just behind the hook. There's the really clever bits, how you rig all this. I mean, again, I learned to do this just from videos, and I'm, you know, not nearly as good as some of these bait fish tires that do it all the time, but... when you're chucking these out and you're fishing them back at a fairly fast speed, I don't really think there's a fish that sees too much of it.
But for me, it's solving the solution today. We've seen them like crash, like, you know, the BBC programme, Blue Planet, where they're absolutely hammering fry, and then we found some today that are just dying, and they're picking them up later, and everything's hammering through. So I'm fishing an articulated fly that's just going to sit there on the bottom, which they've been picking up today. It's been quite strange how the fish have been feeding today. There's been no retrieving, it's just... been literally, it's been dead on the bottom.
Taking it on the...
No, it's as if they've gone through and then they've just hit it while it's been dead on the bottom.
You see, with the material being fairly light as well, you're probably not going to... It's probably not going to catch up too much, you know, on the floor either, and with the jig head pointed down.
Yeah.
The fly is going
to
be very...
That's what I want it to do, almost stand up, which is what it's going to do, isn't it?
I suppose with this, yeah, you could
is
even...
Is that quite a buoyant material as well?
It is, and you could also use, like, you know, a bit of crossover from the fly fishing boys there. You could use some gink and rub it well in, or,
yeah,
you know, anything that's gink, like a silicon-based product to help. Or you could even, in that first section we tied, you could actually put a lump of foam in there as well. I mean, obviously, this sort of thing we cast on a fly rod. We don't do...
Yeah.
You know, obviously you wouldn't cast it with the size weight that we've put on it for this particular one, but I think the theory is the same as regards imitation.
So with imitation, then, say you're matching the hatch with the fly, you'd know you'd be able to tie a buzzer if there's a certain type of buzzer coming off. You'd be able to tie a daddy if there's daddy long legs coming off. So if there's a roach, if they're hammering roach fry, you reckon you can knock them up as well?
Yeah, I dare say we could. Mm-hmm. I mean, things like these marker pens, which we'll get to shortly after we've finished rigging this, you'll see how you can colour these things to suit yourself. You can
I wasn't going to butt in and ask that, mate, because it looks like at the moment it just looks like a ball of white fluff.
It
like
does.
A bale of hay, bale of hay, yeah, fly.
The scissors are going to.
We're going to do a bit of hairdressing.
Yeah, we're going to do a bit of cutting in a while, just to try and give it that bit of a tapered, you know, bait fish kind of pattern. But for now, you know, it'll all start to make sense when we do the hairdressing part.
But the trick, do a lot of this stuff as well, don't you, mate? You do a lot of touring. I know you go out to Italy.
Yeah, I go to Italy once a year for the Italian School of Fly Fishing, and we go to their festival, which is at Castel di Sangro, which is in Abruzzo, which basically means we get to show off what we do and also eat some fantastic food and drink some great wine, which there's always a plus side to everything.
Because, you know, this is getting big in lure fishing. People are tying little jig heads per perch. What they're doing is like little weighted jig heads, more or less. They're tying the fly on a jig head. So they're getting into it. It's a nice side to the sport, I think, making your own lures, isn't it?
It makes sense. I mean, if you think that's probably not nearly as new as we maybe make it out to be, but things like when, for salmon fishing, them flying seas that came out that actually had bucktail on the back up.
Yeah.
And some of the big pike lures have had bits of red wool on the trailing hooks. Ondex lures, that was another one, wasn't it?
Yeah, a bit of red wool.
So I think the idea's been there for a long time, but some of the materials that we do have allow that to be, you know, elaborated on even more.
How long do you reckon it'd take you to learn something like this? If I wanted to say, if I got roach flies and I wanted to tie up a roach pattern?
That's a good question. I don't think it'd realistically take too long a time, as long as you've got good basic materials. The key with fly dressing is buy something that's right for the job rather than something that will do.
I think patience is a big key, because I've had it going, mate. My last creation I did, I spent 3 hours on, and then spent 20 minutes in the shop buying them. I just gave up.
So what we've done, that's the back of the fly, that's the articulated bit as it stands at the moment. So by the time that's rigged, that's going to be, would you say about the size you were after?
That's it, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, they're okay. Roughly about 4 inches, the fish for the fry. Little perch fry. Have you found them doing that, hammering their own? They become cannibalistic and hammering a lot of perch.
They do. I mean, I've caught a lot of big perch on the fly rod when I've been pike fly fishing.
And they've coughed up little perch.
Yeah, all the time.
Everywhere lately. I think it seems to be a seasonal thing as well. At this time of year, I've seen that happening a hell of a lot everywhere. Hmm. That they're coughing up a lot of fry.
So what we'll do is we'll put some silk down on the back of the hook. Ooh. Careful with super glue, get it everywhere. I just make sure that all them turns of tying thread are bedded down really well. Now the next bit what we're going to do, which I've put down there, is a bit of the old biting wire.
Oh.
It's not really, if you're going to use it for catching hopefully large perch, then I don't really think it's
what's that matter for, too then? Much. You can do, this is for doing a wire trace?
No, it's not a wire trace. What we're actually going to do is we're going to use this for rigging this tail section.
Ah, I got you, yeah, I'm with you.
So, in actual fact, that's just a bit frayed there, so.
How long would you expect one of these to last? So, soft plastic, especially if I hit a couple of pike, it's
Indefinitely, really. These are quite resilient. And what you can always do is these tail sections, when you've tied them,
replace them.
Well, yeah, that'll last more or less forever. If your hook gets a bit blunt, you could tie up a new front section and re-rig the back part if you wanted it to.
You know, I'm going to try and catch something on this now.
I'd hope you will.
Bring from pudding and stuff. What's these little things you're adding on?
Just a little fluorescent bead. I think this is probably from a sea fishing shop.
So there's quite a few components then.
Yep, absolutely. I'm just going to shove that right down.
Oh, I see what you're doing, yeah. Tip on the loop.
Yeah, you've got it. And then just tie that in. In a few minutes, you'll not notice because that will all be covered. Just pull that either side there.
So the bead's not for attraction purposes, is this for just...
No, oddly enough, that is a glow-in-the-dark bead.
But it is just for attaching that loop.
Yeah, I mean, that it's just a shape that seems to, for me, fits well in with what we're doing. And I'm just going to lash that all the way down the shank to about maybe an eighth of an inch from behind that shot there. And then I'm going to bend that wire back one side at a time.
What's that for?
It's just to stop it slipping out.
Oh, I got you, okay.
You know, if you, there's no hook in the tail.
I think when I attempted fly tying, I was a bit heavy with glue. I just glued everything. I never got to this stage of whipping stuff on. It was loads of super glue.
And super
packet
glue
of crisp is... buzzer is about as far as I can get, mate.
Crisp packet buzzer. Was it cheese-flavoured Doritos that you used?
No, it was... I started one and then I went and bought one from the shops because it didn't work out that well.
So we've buried them tag ends into there.
Do you just cover everything up the sharpness?
Just yeah, it's just to stop it from fraying the frame. I'm just going to alter that, sit it forward slightly there. And we're going to get another bit of that.
Right,
not far off being done. There's the scissors.
Same again, just cut the one side of this.
Yeah, cut the one side.
Yeah.
It's really not, if you've had a go at tying flies before, you'll know about hackles and things like that. It's basically making like a very, very large and very, very dense synthetic hackle.
Got you. And could you get these flies, say if I wanted one in the summer, could you get them to almost float, ride really high on the surface? Is there a material that's that buoyant? Or does everything...
You'd probably be as well, I think, keeping the shape and everything the same and maybe just changing your jig head for a popper head.
All right.
That might be...
A bit of foam.
Yeah, just a lump of foam. Yeah. Like, you know, take something out of the trout angler's book there and use the old booby foam.
I think there's a lot of this. This is what I'm liking with lure fishing. There's a lot of crossover. I can pinch stuff from a trout angler. You can pinch stuff from... So on and so forth, here, there and everywhere, from every angler, really.
You're
even, fishing, isn't it? Just
you're even going to get that with carp angling. I mean, look at how they use the pop-up boilies. They can get punches and things like that now to enable them to put bits of foam in the boilies. That's, just trying to part that there and find a piece of that core, that edge. If you like to
stick it down
to tie on with, yeah.
How do you know how much material to use, or is it just experience?
It's guesswork, yeah. I mean, today we're probably just being a bit lavish with it. You know, I'm not too worried about wasting a little bit of this today. I've just tied that in there, but as you get more experienced, I guess you get to know just how much material you'll use on a particular fly, like when I'm tying, you know, my orders and things like that, and I'm tying, I don't know, say a blob with Fritz for trout, which is the most, you know, unimitive fly pattern, but it's also an effective one, and it, you know, look like it a load that it's here to stay, but I get to know just how much of that Fritz I need to use. So you can see now that we've started putting that on, it's actually covering that bead and that rigging wire.
Yeah. I still can't envisage this taking place. I just can't see the end product. That's where I'm going wrong.
It's not had its air cut yet, Steve.
Oh, okay.
The last couple of minutes of tying this pattern and doing the artwork with it make more sense than the rest of the fly.
Do you think this is as much as part of fly fishing as the actual fly fishing? Just catching the fish, just getting into this.
For me, yes, but if I was to say to you across all disciplines of angling, whether it be from being competitive or just general preparation for a day's fishing, there are parts of what you take with you that you can buy, and you could probably buy better than you make once played about with making a few floats for pole fishing. Mm-hmm. And the upshot was I wasn't very good at it, and I could buy better than I could make. So happy to buy that bit. It was better for me to spend my time making sure that my bait was well prepared than trying to mess about making a float that realistically wouldn't give me an edge.
Commercially made patterns are very good, aren't they?
They are now, yeah. And things like, there's a lot of like even flies and likes of some of the bigger companies, Fulling Mill in particular, create some great flies.
There's definitely this in this lure fishing though, where I found myself where I could have done with something and there hasn't been anything made. Like today, I wanted something with a floating body, probably the hook at the back end of the body that just wiggled just on the bottom, just a very, very dull movement, just to replicate one of those fish that they've hammered and has fell to the bottom.
Yeah, perhaps.
It's definitely where the big girls were.
Take advantage of the undertow and things like that. Yeah.
So the perch in here, mate, how long are they a year class? Or because they've definitely been getting bigger, haven't they?
Yeah.
We've done big fish on it. It's been fantastic for big fish, this water, Tough Newton.
Yeah, I mean, we've never realised completely its potential because I think we've kept it pretty much as a closed book for such a long time.
Yeah.
You know, we've not actively promoted any form of a fishing for them. It's just been really whether your face fits and, you know, so as to whether we decided to let people on.
Yeah.
Whereas now we're actively letting people on by appointment.
Yeah.
So we've not really had a true indication of it. You can imagine there's been a lot of decent perch over the years caught by nothing other than accident by trout anglers.
Yeah.
You know, which embrace it, appreciate it, accept it for what it is because they're lovely fish.
Oh, they're crackers.
You sometimes get people that won't appreciate what they actually have caught.
Oh, it's been phenomenal sport. I don't think I've fished more than, I don't think we've been giving it more than an hour and a half, have we, really, fishing, actual hard fishing? It's been just a couple of hours and some fantastic, this has been fish of a lifetime there. They've been beautiful, beautiful fish. But it's got some other big fish in as well, hasn't it, this place?
We've got some big bream, we've got some big roach. There was actually a chap while he was buzzer fishing for trout caught a roach.
Yeah.
He took a scale off it and sent it to, I think, probably the Environment Agency. To have it verified, and it came back with a report saying that it was a bona fide roach, and that was 4 pounds 3 ounces.
Never.
So I mean,
wow,
it's definitely got potential across the board. Right,
what is it, do you reckon? Neglect, or the fact that it's good water quality, is it good bloodworm matches, is that what
there
is?
Are a lot of bloodworm in there. I mean, if you went for a day's buzzer fishing for trout and then fished at anchor and started pulling the anchor up and moving around every now and then, you'd find some of the clay and you'd see just how many bloodworm in there. So there is a lot of natural food and neglect, you know, they're not actually getting fished for.
Okay.
Right, so like we said before, that at the moment is a bit of a mess,
ball of fluff.
So what we're going to do is we're going to give it a trim.
There we go.
This is where the hairdressing malarkey starts.
I'm going to ask you questions like hairdresser. Have you been on your holidays?
That sounds good to me.
Have you been on your holidays?
Yeah, I went to Italy in the summer.
Oh, lovely. I don't think me and you frequent hairdressers that much.
Actually, I go and have this. I go and have this look maintained once a fortnight.
Same here.
Half all over.
It's hard to keep like us, isn't it, mate?
You don't get to be
high maintenance.
Such an icon of ladies' magazines. So just there's nothing, you know.
I feel your pain there, mate. Yeah, I know the score. So he's just trimming it. Is it a set pattern, or he's just cutting it to what you feel is?
Yeah, just really to what I feel's.
Yeah.
About right.
Gotta be careful though. You can't put it back on, can you? Really?
Well, it's like ground bait. You can't take it out once you've thrown it in, can you?
And just noticed as well, it's got like a little sparkle pattern in that material, hasn't it?
Yeah, that'll just give like a suggestion of a scale pattern.
Yeah.
That sort of thing. You can see now it's getting really more towards like a
proper fish.
A bait fish kind of a shape, can't you?
Yeah. So historically, what's it done them up to? Yes, or has it been tales of like a trout angler's caught a big one?
Um, it tales of, and again, really, there's a lot of 2-2.5 pound fish and bigger been caught in the past, but generally, my anglers fishing for trout that, you know, in fairness, don't appreciate that some lure men would give the right arm to be catching those. It's
a good sport. I fish for them on trout only waters. It's a good sport on 5 and 6 weights. It's cracking sports. We use great big damsels, proper tungsten beads on them, and just drop them down. Yeah.
Right, so you've got your shape, that's your outline.
There's my fin, that looks good.
Got some articulation.
Still not a perch, though, mate. I'm still not a perch.
So, what colours you got in a perch? You've got a bit of yellow, a bit of orange.
A bit of yellow, orange, and green,
some orange in the tail already. So, there's your green.
Ah.
And we're going to colour that by using some marker pens. So what I'm going to do is start at the head there. I'm going to draw a big green back on this perch. I'm going to come all the way.
Look at that.
Down the back. And perched in match fishing circles for years and years and years have been nicknamed footballers.
Yeah,
so
stripes,
we'll put some stripes down each side.
That's amazing how that's taking place.
But you can see now, is it starting to look a bit like a...
It's starting to get perchy like, yeah.
Right.
Can I name this fly then, Andy? Is this my fly?
You can name this fly.
So this might go down in history.
Finding...
Like a shipman's buzzer.
Yeah,
Is it going to get that much notoriety?
Yeah, maybe not quite.
Not the other shipman. The shipman's buzzer.
Yeah, the shipman's buzzer and not named.
See, they haven't moved on, have they? Has that evolved? Flies like that?
Yeah, different tales of who, where and why every week, I think, in this game. And in angling, it does end up being a bit of a game of Chinese whispers. So perch, really, there's not... hell of a lot of white in them, is there? It's more like a mucky white.
Yeah.
And obviously we've used a white material, so I'm just going to stain some of that there, really, by just putting yellow fleck through it down the sides. Bit of yellow underneath. Still leaving a good bit of white in there.
Yeah.
So I think you can sort of see where your perch pattern's going with that.
Is that waterproof as well, that stuff?
That's waterproof pen, yeah, and you can always, you know, you can always recolour them a bit as you go.
Yeah.
And we can put some eyes on that. Now, the only thing you've got to tell me with this is, do you want the eyes on the jig head or would you like them set a bit further back?
I'm going to use your expertise. No, I'm going to go for them on the jig head.
You want them on the jig head?
I think so, yeah. I'm calling the shots here, so yeah, we'll have them on the jig head. That'll be interesting. We've got different eyes.
I've got all sorts of different eyes. In fact, I'm going to elaborate ever so slightly with these, and I'm going to just give them a bit of a trigger point with the eyes. I'm going to use something that's very, very bright, like a foil type of eye.
This is amazing, this lot is.
And these are a bit bigger than some of the others as well. So again, stick on. Put the one on this side towards us for a start. And
is
what
this
I'm
the magic glue again?
Magic glue's coming out. And I'm just going to go right round that.
If you're watching this, it might seem a bit long-winded, isn't it? But since I've been, it's just fascinating to watch. It's
I think it's that whole thing of preparing your own lures, your own baits,
yeah,
which, you know, comes back to them skills.
Can't wait to use it.
I think you do need to catch me a fish on this afternoon.
No more luck, mate. I'm going to straighten a snag. It'll be dug up by a time team in a few thousand years.
And put it in one of those capsules and bury it, you know. So, yeah.
That really is weird stuff, that is. That's just...
the magic glue.
Yeah. It's going to be, I think I've had it suggested to me, it's going to be the percoletta. Percoletta fly. That's him. It's a bit of my name, a bit of perch. Do you enjoy this? Do you like just, do you really take this? Is it a bit like painting? Or
yeah, I mean,
or?
No, a tie flies for, you know, sort of.
Because you do it like almost commercially, don't you? Because it's like a cottage industry.
Yeah, a tie flies for probably 60% of my living anyway. Mm. But even then, I do get days when it's just sort of playtime, you know, where I get my creative license in full flow.
Just amazing.
That's a bit lavish, not quite as neat with that second bit of glue, but.
Doesn't matter, mate. It's I understand do you've got a working fishery here, and I'm probably holding customers up as well, mate. Right. So. That is weird stuff, that is.
And there he is.
Look at him.
He's looking a bit more like, he's heavy, he's looking a bit more like a perch.
I want him heavy, I want him roughly, probably 15 grams. I bet it's not far off 15 gram, that.
I bet it's not. And then, that's of course, it's at. Got that wiggly tail look.
Oh, mate.
You can see there.
Just give it, I want to go and have a go. Look at that little baby. Absolutely fantastic. Andy, cheers for that, mate. I want to go and give it a go. Cheers, pal.